हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, आई होप ऑल ऑफ यू आर डूइंग वेल इन दिस सडन आउटब्रेक ऑफ COVID-19 कीपिंग अस इनसाइड आवर होम्स फॉर ओवर एन मंथ नाउ। सो इन दिस क्रिटिकल सिचुएशन वी आर ट्राइंग टू रीच टू यू बाय द टीचिंग लर्निंग सेशन दैट वी आर ऑर्गेनाइजिंग इट ऑनलाइन एंड यू कैन डेली गेट यू आर गेटिंग द अपडेट्स डेली ओवर द एडू कैंपस ऐप एंड वी आर ऑल्सो कॉन्टेक्टिंग यू टू reach the lectures that you are uploading daily and contacting you via the online procedure. So in the last lecture we discussed about the automata. In the automata we discussed about the push down automata and the basic concepts of the push down automata, the pros and cons, what were the problems in finite automata that we need to introduce the push down automata. So we are going to continue the lecture of that. So let's start, and if you are going to have any queries regarding the last lecture or today's lecture, you can always call me, text me, like anytime. Okay. Thank you. So let's begin today's lecture about the push down automata examples, and let's try to figure out. Okay, so today we are going to discuss about push down automata and we are going to see some examples. In the last lecture we have already discussed about the push down automata and we discussed that what are the pros and cons of push down automata, and we saw that the push down automata is basically finite automata with the concept of stack. So there was two more new tuples that were introduced in push down automata. The one was representing the stack, and another was representing the initial symbol that is already inside the stack. So the symbol that was denoting the stack was called tau, and the symbol that was the initial symbol inside the stack that was called Z0. Now the concept of the stack was introduced in push down automata so that we can overcome the problem of the having the control of number of input alphabets that we are going to have inside any kind of language or any kind of transition diagram. That was the main problem in finite automata, right? We saw an example of a to the power n, b to the power n, where we saw that we cannot solve it using the finite automata, and due to that restriction we have to move to the push down automata. Okay. So we are going to explore such examples where we can overcome it with push down automata and we cannot deal it with the regular finite automata or regular grammars. Okay, so let's begin today's lecture at this note. So this is the problem that we are going to discuss today, that construct a push down automata that accepts the language a to the power n, b to the power n, n is greater than equals to 1, where sigma equals to a comma b. That means the languages that are going to be accepted, we have to first of all consider the input alphabets are only a comma b, and the most important thing over here is a to the power n, b to the power n. That means this number of a's and number of b's are always going to be same under any circumstances. Okay, so in this case the language that are going to be accepted by this particular or for this particular example are going to look like this. That means AB, double A, double B, triple A, triple B, 4A, 4E, 4Bs, that are the main languages that going to be accepted by the push down automata. Now what is the main funda behind this whole thing? That we have to draw the transition diagram such that it is going to be accepted by the particular or the particular language is going to be accepted by that particular transition diagram. Okay, so that means all of these are going to be accepted. Okay, now there are some constraints over here. You have to first of all remember the number of a's and number of b's are always going to be same. Okay, because there is a to the power n and b to the power n. So that means if there are 3 a's, there should be 3 b's. If there are 2 a, there should be 2 b, and if there is 1 a, there should be 1 b. Another is n should be greater than equals to 1, so epsilon is not going to be accepted. A should be always followed by b's. Okay, so you can see that A should be always followed by B, because it is going to have n is going to have be greater than equals to 1. So in that case it is going to be AB, AABB, AAA, BBB, like that. So that is the main concept. Now before proceeding to the solution of this thing, you have to understand that how this thing is going to work. Okay, so in last class we have talked that there are two conditions, under two circumstances it can get accepted. One was, number one was when you are going to reach the final state, and number two was when the stack is empty. Now how this stack is going to work, let's assume for this particular language AAA and BBB. You have to keep in mind certain rules that are going to be followed in pushdown automata. Initially there is going to be Z0, that you have already seen in our tuples. Initially it should be Z0, that means whenever there is nothing, it is Z0 is there. Next thing, whenever you are going to push something inside the stack, first of all whatever is at the top of that thing is going to be extracted. So let's say that I am going to push an A inside the stack, that means this Z0 should be extracted first, it should be combined with the A, then it gets back, it gets thrown back inside. So in that case we are going to have AZ0, right? In the next loop, if I want to throw another A inside this, what I have to do, I have to pop this A out, combine it with another A and throw them back inside so that I can have 2A. Again, if I want to throw another A over here, I have to pop this top A out and do the same thing. Combine it with an A and throw it back inside. Okay. So that is how it is going to work. Regardless of whatever symbol you are going to use, first of all, whatever is at the top of the stack, you have to pop it out. Then you combine it with the symbol, then you throw it back inside, and that is how it is going to work. I hope it is clear for everyone, because the total examples or the total lecture about the pushdown automata is going to be based on this particular theory. Okay, so you push whatever is at the top, sorry, you pop whatever is at the top, you apply the symbol, throw it back inside. Okay, let me just erase it, because now we are going to the solve of this particular problem. Now there are two possibilities were there. One, we can either reach the final state or we can empty the stack. So if we empty the stack, what we are going to have? Z0, initially we have nothing else. So if we empty the stack, what we are going to have? Z0 only. So let's take an example of these three. So A is always going to be first and then it should be B. So I can apply a logic. Always remember that for every problem the logic should be different, but you have to apply it on your mind, okay, such that the language gets accepted. The proper way is to take a complex language of acceptance. For example, I could have done this, but instead I went for this. I mean, this is also fine, but this is a little bit complex than this one, so I chose this. Okay, so that is another thing, but let's get back to this particular example. Now my logic is, I don't want to reach the final state, I just want to make the stack empty so that my language gets accepted by that particular transition diagram. So that means after finishing the transition diagram, Z0 should be only alone. Okay, so how can I do that? You have to remember A should be followed by B, that means A should be always stacked inside. So that means if I am always pushing A inside, B is always going to pop the A outside. Okay, so that means whenever you are applying the A alphabet, push. When we are going to apply B alphabet, pop. Rather, push A and pop A. So whenever we are applying 3 A's, you are going to push 3 A's. Whenever I am applying 3 B's, you are going to pop 3 A's. So in that case,
the total stack should be empty or whatever we had in the initially. So now let's try to solve it. Let's say that Q naught is the initial state. We are applying A on it. Okay. So whenever we are applying A, as I told you that in the beginning we had Z0. So whenever we are applying A, that means we are going to take Z0 out, combine it with A, and then we are going to push it back inside. Throw it back inside. So A is applied, Z0 is at the top. So this is the state you are getting, that is AZ0. Okay. Is it clear to everyone? I hope it is clear to everyone. You have to write it like this, that the input symbol, whatever is top of the stack and whatever you are getting. In the next one, so A has been pushed inside. We have to push another A over here. So at the top there is one A, and we are applying the alphabet A. We are going to get AA. Why so? Because this A was taken out, combined it with the new A, this one, and this is what we are going to throw it back inside. So this is AA. So similarly, this process is going to carry on for every input symbol. So you can give a self loop over here. Okay. So this is done. I hope this is clear to everyone. So 3 A's has been processed over here. Now you are going to see what is going to happen for B. We are now applying B. So whenever we are going to apply B over here, what is at the top of the stack? We are going to have this particular A. Now this A has been taken outside whenever we are going to apply B. Now what was the condition? That whenever we are applying B, you pop one A out. That means it has already been popped. So you don't throw back anything inside. Okay. So if you don't throw back anything inside, actually you are throwing epsilon or null inside. So this A has been popped outside and you are throwing nothing inside. So that means this A has been popped. Okay. So let's say we have reached Q1. Using this. Is it clear to everyone? So I have already said that whenever, regardless of the input alphabets, it is always going to be the rule that first of all, whatever is at the top of the stack, you pop it out, you combine it with whatever you want to throw, then you throw it back inside. If you don't want to throw it back inside, just don't throw anything, right? So in this case, we throw the A because we want to throw, or we want to push the A inside. In case of B, we want to just pop. We don't want to push anything. So it has already been popped. So we are not throwing anything inside. That is why epsilon is written over here. So this thing can happen for number of B's that are present. So this has happened for the first B. For next two B's, you can give a self loop. Or let's say if there was 4 A's and 4 B's, it would have been also true. Okay. So this is done. That means all A's and all B's has been popped out. Now there are two conditions under which circumstances it should be accepted, right? One circumstance is this, that the stack should be empty. That is actually number two. And number one was we have to reach the final state. So let's say this Q2 is the final state. So if it is the final state, we are going to get wherever we have started from. That means Z0, we started from Z0. So here, after doing this, we are going to have nothing. We are only going to have Z0 at the top of the stack. Okay. So you apply nothing on Z0, and as Z0 came back outside, for the applying of the input alphabet, that is epsilon, that means even if you don't apply any input alphabet, also then it is going to come out. Then again you are going to throw it back inside, so you throw z0 inside. So that's how you are going to get the final state, that is q2. So in the q2 final state we are going to get only z0. Okay, this is one. Another solve can be this one, that we want to pop this z0 outside. So again, for this one z0 was already popped, but we throw the z0 inside because we want to reach the final state. So if you don't want to reach the final state and just want to make the stack empty, so z0 was already popped out, you don't throw back anything. So epsilon z0 and you don't throw back anything. Okay, so in this way the total stack is going to be empty, and that is both of them are accepted actually. So you can either use this one or you can use this one. Okay, both are accepted. So let me just give a fresh picture of this thing. I hope it is clear to everyone. Because always remember that whenever we are applying any alphabet, be it A, B, 0, 1, epsilon, anything, you are going to pop out whatever is at the top of the stack. So this is the fresh picture of the total thing that we worked out. Now this is the transition diagram that we have already drawn. Now what is the transition function? You have to write the transition function in this way. So initially we had q0, we are applying A, and z0 was at the top of the stack. What we are getting? q0 az0, this thing. Similarly for the next one, you are applying A again at the top of the stack. There was A. What you are getting? q0 AA. Similarly for the next one, you had q0, you are applying B at the top of the stack, you had A. What you are getting? q1 and epsilon. Similarly these two. Okay, so that is how the transition function can be done. So this is how we try to solve any problem using the pushdown automata. You have to keep in mind the constraints, and according to the constraints you have to judge what you can do to either reach to the final state, and or you can make the stack empty. So this is one example, one prime example. Try to understand what I just discussed thoroughly, that first of all you have to remember what is the initial symbol. Initially we had z0, we tried to push A. So in order to push A, you have to pop the z0 outside, and then you have to push the az0. If you don't want to push anything inside, that means if you want to pop any particular symbol, just throw the epsilon over there, and that's the way you can pop it. So for pushing, you can push the particular alphabet, and for popping, you just throw the epsilon. For both of these cases, you can see that you have thrown the epsilon over here. In all of the cases. So thank you for listening to this lecture. This was a very important lecture in this pushdown automata session. In the next session we will look at some more of the examples. Stay safe, stay at home. Catch you in the next one. Thank you. Bye.